Hello all, so welcome to Dr. Ankit Pharmacology series. So now today we will be discussing about an updated lecture on skeletal muscle relaxants. Okay, now we know that as the word implies, skeletal muscle relaxant, they will relax skeletal muscles. Now if you think about what should be the uses of a skeletal muscle relaxants, so if you talk about the uses of skeletal muscle relaxant, the first use is during surgery or during surgical procedures. Okay, during surgery we use skeletal muscle relaxant so that patient should not move. During laryngoscopy, okay, laryngoscopy we give. We also give during intubation. Intubation means when you want to insert an endotracheal tube. When you want to insert endotracheal tube for mechanical ventilation. Okay, and lastly, in cases of muscle spasm or muscle rigidity. So these are the four uses of skeletal muscle relaxants. Okay, now let's see how normally what is the normal anatomy by which skeletal muscles are normally supplied by the nerves. Okay, suppose this is the brain. Okay, this is the brain. And from the brain, we know in the central nervous system, in the brain, the nerve arises. This nerve goes to the spinal cord. They relay in spinal cord. And remember, from spinal cord, peripheral nerve arises. Okay? Peripheral nerve arises. And this peripheral nerves, remember, it releases a chemical known as acetylcholine. It releases a neurotransmitter known as acetylcholine. Now, this acetylcholine, when released, act on the muscle. Suppose this is the muscle. On muscle, there is a receptor of acetylcholine. That receptor is known as NM receptor. Okay, NM stands for nicotinic M receptor. Okay, now when acetylcholine is released, this acetylcholine act on NM receptor, and this NM receptor, remember, leads to depolarization of muscle and causes skeletal muscle contraction. It causes skeletal muscle contraction. Okay, so this junction of between muscle and spinal nerve and muscle, suppose this is the nerve and this is the muscle, this junction is known as neuromuscular junction. Okay, so this junction or synaptic area is known as neuromuscular junction or NM junction. Okay, NM junction. So you should not get confused between NM receptor and NM junction. NM receptor is a receptor on skeletal muscle. Neuromuscular junction is the space between peripheral nerve and muscles. Okay, now let's see, we have three types of skeletal muscle relaxants. Okay, so if you talk about, we have three types of skeletal muscle relaxants. The first type of skeletal muscle relaxant we have, which will act at a level of brain and spinal cord. Okay, they will act at a level of brain and spinal cord. These skeletal muscle relaxants are known as centrally acting skeletal muscle relaxant. They are known as centrally acting skeletal muscle relaxants. Okay, so what is their site of action? They will act at the level of brain or spinal cord, and they will inhibit these nerves. Okay, so the first will be centrally acting skeletal muscle relaxant. Now the second type of skeletal muscle relaxant we have, that will block NM receptor. Okay, the drugs that will block NM receptor, that is nicotine NM receptors, these receptors, they act at a level of neuromuscular junctions. Okay, so they act at a level of neuromuscular junction, so they are known as NM blockers, neuromuscular blockers, and they block NM receptor. Okay, so nicotinic muscular blockers, sorry, they block which receptor? Nicotine M blocker. Okay, they block this receptor N. Now the third type of skeletal muscle relaxant we have, that will go inside the muscle and they will cause muscle relaxation by some different mechanisms. Okay, so lastly we will be having is direct मसल रिलैक्सेंट्स, ओके, डायरेक्ट मसल रिलैक्सेंट्स. सो दीज ड्रग्स दे विल गो इनसाइड द मसल एंड दे विल इनहिबिट सर्टेन कैल्शियम एंड सोडियम आयंस थ्रू विच दे विल इनहिबिट मसल कॉन्ट्रैक्शन. सो अमंग देम द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट ग्रुप ऑफ ड्रग फॉर यू दैट इज NM ब्लॉकर्स, ओके, दैट इज NM ब्लॉकर्स, ओके. सो यू हैव टू रिमेंबर दैट दिस इज द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट ग्रुप. सो ए बी एंड सी वी विल स्टार्ट विथ फर्स्ट द ड्रग्स विच विल ब्लॉक NM रिसेप्टर. So we will start with a drug that will block NM receptor. So we will write the first class of skeletal muscle relaxant as the drugs acting on nicotinic M receptors. Okay. So these are the drugs. So let's discuss in great detail how does it function. So we have already discussed, suppose this is a nerve. This is a spinal nerve. Remember, spinal nerve releases acetylcholine. Spinal nerve releases acetylcholine. And this acetylcholine goes on the muscle. Suppose this is the muscle. And on muscle, we have a receptor known as NM receptors. Okay? NM receptor. NM stands for nicotine M receptor. Nicotine M receptor. M for muscle. Now remember, when acetylcholine act on this nicotine M receptor, this nicotine M receptor becomes opened, opens. When acetylcholine act here, it becomes open. And remember, from outside, sodium gets transmitted or sodium influx occurs. Now this sodium movement inside the muscle causes depolarization of muscle. And remember, depolarization of muscle leads to depolarization of muscle leads to muscle contraction. Okay, so if you talk about this NM receptor in great detail, if you talk about this NM receptor, what is the shape of this NM receptor or nicotine M receptor? This nicotine M receptor, remember, is an ionotropic receptor. It's an ionotropic receptor. And the shape of ionotropic receptor is just like a flower, rose-like flower, which has 5 subunit. Okay? So the shape is pentameric rosette type. Okay? So the shape is pentameric rosette type. So its shape, you will write, is pentameric rosette type. Now, rose means just like a rose flower. Pentameric means it has 5 subunits. That is alpha, beta, gamma, delta, and one more alpha. So there are 2 alpha subunit and beta, gamma, delta subunit. Okay. Now, remember, when if you see this diagram in from the front view, if you think see this diagram from the front view. So it will have a shape, it will have an inner hole, and there are 5 leaf-like flower projections, 5 projections like there. So there is a central pore, so alpha, beta, gamma, alpha and delta. Okay, so it is just like this. Now there is a central pore. Remember, through this central pore, sodium can go inside to the muscle cell. Okay. Sodium can go inside into the muscle cells. So when this channel becomes opened due to the action of acetylcholine, sodium ion moves inside. Sodium influx occurs. Okay. Sodium influx causes muscle depolarization. Depolarized muscle, remember, releases calcium, which can lead to muscle contraction. Now let's see what are the drugs we have which will block NM receptors. So the drugs which block NM receptors are NM receptors are, they are of two type, okay, they are of two type, we will write. So there are two types of skeletal muscle relaxants. So they are skeletal muscle relaxant. The first one we will write are, they are known as depolarizing blockers. First one, they are known as depolarizing blockers. The second one we will write, the second type of drug we will have is non-depolarizing blockers. So before learning what is their mechanism of action, so first we will write the names of these two skeletal muscle relaxants. Among depolarizing blockers, we have two drugs. The first drug is succinylcholine. The first drug we have is succinylcholine. And the second drug we have is dicamethonine. Okay, dicamethonine. So how to remember? They are ending with the word methonium. Okay, now among non-depolarizing blocker, we have, they are further divided upon their chemical nature. There are three types we will write. One we will write, they are steroidal drug. Their chemical nature is steroid. Second, they have ammonium compound, so their chemical structure is benzyl isoquinoline derivative. Benzyl isoquinoline derivatives. And lastly, we have a separate drug, that is galamine. Okay, galamine. Now, how to remember their name? Any drug amongst steroidal, it will end with the word curonium. It will end with the word curonium. So we can write their names. So we will write a mnemonic PVR. Okay. From P we will write, there are two drugs, pipe curonium, pan curonium. Okay. V for V curonium. And from R again we have two, rho curonium and rapacuronium. Okay, now among benzyl isoquinoline derivative, we have the drugs, either they will end with the word curare, they will end with the word curine, or they will end with the word curium. Okay, or they will end with the word curium. Now you can see that their names are very similar to each. Now, it has a long history that in South America, there was a tribe which used a poison. That poison was known as curare poison. Curare poison. So, there was a history that there was a curare poison. I will come back to the history of this poison. But before that, we will write the names of the drug. The first drug you will write is D. That is the D isomer, tubocurare. D tubocurare. Second drug we will write is metoclopramide. Etracurium, doxacurium, cis etracurium. Okay, then we will write mevacurium, and lastly gantacurium. Okay, lastly gantacurium. So we can write a mnemonic T, that is the T tubocurare, M A D A M and G. So you can make a mnemonic T Madam G. Okay, and lastly we have galamine. Now what is the why we are writing their name with curonium, curare, curium and curonium? Because if you talk about the history, if you talk about a little bit of historical part, that there was a poison known as curare. There was a poison known as curare, which was obtained from a plant Kinodendron, and this poison was used by South American tribe, a very old poison, South American tribe, for hunting. Okay, so because they used to put this poison on their arrow, they used to push this arrow into an animal, the animal becomes paralyzed and they can easily hang. So that was a history. So it was a poison known as curare. So from this curare, we have modified these curare into various drugs. Now among them, remember, this galamine is not used. This galamine also has a property, but it is not used. The reason is, this galamine is highly nephrotoxic drug. It damages kidney. And remember, it causes severe tachycardia. Okay, so during surgery, if you are using it, it may cause severe tachycardia, the patient may die on the table, okay, because of increased demand of the heart. It may lead to arrhythmias, MIs, etc. So let's see what is the difference between this depolarizing blockers overall and these non-depolarizing blockers, okay. So let's see the difference between depolarizing and non-depolarizing. So all non-depolarizing, they are exactly same. So let's see the difference between depolarizing and non-depolarizing blockers, okay. So we will make a heading, depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant, and second is NDMR. NDMR stands for non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant, non-depolarizing muscle relaxants, okay. So among here, the prototype drug we have is succinylcholine, and here the prototype drug is D-tubocurare, okay, which we take as a standard drug. Now first of all, what is the mechanism of action, okay. So first we will write the mechanism of action of curare like drug. These curare like drug, remember, they are competitive antagonist of NM receptor. That means they will block this NM receptor through that same site where acetylcholine normally binds. So it will inhibit the attachment of acetylcholine. And we know that acetylcholine causes muscle contraction. So it will lead to, muscle will not contract, it will lead to flaccid muscle paralysis. It will lead to flaccid muscle paralysis. Okay. So why? Because it will inhibit the attachment of acetylcholine. Acetylcholine normally causes influx of sodium. It will inhibit sodium influx. If the sodium is not influx, can we say the muscle will not depolarize? Hence the muscle will not depolarize because of no sodium influx. Hence they are known as non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant. So if you make a diagram, this is a muscle. We know when acetylcholine act on NM receptor, normally sodium moves inside and sodium causes depolarization. These drugs, they block this receptor, hence sodium will not come inside, hence the muscle will not depolarize, hence they are non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant. Okay. Now if you want to overcome the effect of these non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant, their antidote will be to increase the level of acetylcholine. To overcome their effect, we will increase the effect of acetylcholine. Okay. Because so acetylcholine will overcome the effect by increasing the concentration, it will compete with this non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant and overcome the effect. Okay. Now if you talk about depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant, let's see what is their mechanism of action. Now they will act in two phases. First they will act in phase one. Okay. So in phase one, what they will be doing, suppose this is the muscle and this is the NM receptor, and phase one you will write is just like acetylcholine. Okay. Acetylcholine, what they will be doing in phase one, they will go and stimulate this receptor. Okay. So in phase one, remember, they go and bind to NM receptor and they will open them. If they will open them, can we say there will be influx of sodium? The sodium will come inside. Influx of sodium. Okay. Now influx of sodium will lead to initial muscle contraction. So it will lead to initial muscle twitching or fasciculation. That means initially the muscle will contract. Okay. Now rapidly it will get converted into phase two. Now what will happen in phase two? These sodium channels from their open state. So these sodium channels from their open state, they come into inactive state. Okay. These sodium channels soon, they will become refractory. Sodium channel, they will soon become refractory and they will stop conducting. Why? Because sodium channel from their open state, they rapidly go into inactive state. Okay, inactive state. Now, because of this reason, what will happen? As they will stop conducting, they will just become phase 2. As they will stop conducting, there will be flaccid muscle paralysis. There will be flaccid muscle paralysis. So, can we say that the paralysis of succinomethonium occurs in which phase? Phase 2. Okay. So, can we say that in phase 1, initially there is muscle contraction due to sudden opening of sodium channel, but soon this sodium channel will become refractory, they will stop conducting. And remember, as they will stop conducting, the flaccid muscle paralysis will occur. But remember, this succinomethonium, it will remain attached here. This succinylcholine will remain attached here, and if there will be acetylcholine, remember, acetylcholine will not able to overcome the effect. Acetylcholine will not able to overcome the effect. Okay, in this case, acetylcholine will overcome the effect. That point I will be telling you shortly. Okay, so remember this point. Now let's see the differences between these two skeletal muscle relaxant differences. So first of all, can you tell me which of the skeletal muscle relaxant will cause initial muscle contraction, like initial muscle twitching or initial muscle fasciculation? Fasciculation means mild contraction. So the answer is depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant or non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant. So the answer out here is depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxants, they will cause initial muscle contraction. There is no initial muscle contraction. Okay. Now this muscle contraction, remember, it can lead to pain and soreness. This muscle fasciculation or twitching can lead to muscle pain and muscle soreness. So it is caused by depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxants. Okay. Now, the second point is increase in acetylcholine will overcome the effect. Will overcome the effect of which skeletal muscle relaxant? The answer is this one, non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant. The reason is they are competitive blocker. Okay, they are competitive blocker. So we can overcome the effect of a competitive blocker by increasing the dose of agonist. Agonist here will be acetylcholine. Now how we can increase the level of acetylcholine in the body? By inhibiting the degradation of acetylcholine by giving a drug known as neostigmine. Remember, neostigmine increases the level of acetylcholine in the body by inhibit its degradation. So acetylcholine is degraded by an enzyme known as acetylcholine esterase. So neostigmine is anti-choline esterase, so it will inhibit that choline esterase enzyme which degrades acetylcholine. So neostigmine will overcome the effect of acetylcholine. Okay, neostigmine will increase acetylcholine and it will overcome the effect of curare like drug. Here there will be no effect. Okay, but remember, in phase 2, no effect in phase 1, because in phase 1, remember, it is just depolarizing muscle just like acetylcholine. But in phase 2, remember, it is blocking the effect of acetylcholine. Phase 2 is just like non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant. Both will have flaccid paralysis. So remember, in phase 2, it can partially overcome the effect. It can partially overcome the effect of blockage by succinomethonium in cases of phase 2. Okay, now the same thing we can do, the same thing we can assess clinically also. We can clinically monitor also. Okay, how we can clinically monitor? Suppose this is a nerve, and we know a nerve releases acetylcholine. So we can also made this release of acetylcholine from the nerve. How we can increase the release of acetylcholine from the nerve? By giving electrical stimulation. If we electrically stimulate a nerve, remember it releases acetylcholine. And can we say that acetylcholine will able to increase, overcome the effect in cases of non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant, but not in cases of succinylcholine. So how do we clinically monitor the effect of these skeletal muscle relaxant? There are certain tests by which we electrically stimulate a nerve and we release acetylcholine. So let's talk about these. Let's talk about these tests. Okay, so we will make a heading: clinical assessment of the effect of skeletal muscle relaxant. So first type of test you will write is known as train of four. Train of four stimulus. Now what will happen in train of four stimulus? We stimulate a nerve known as ulnar nerve. Okay, so you have stimulated an ulnar nerve, and this ulnar nerve, remember, will release acetylcholine, and this acetylcholine will cause contraction of muscle. Now which muscle we generally assess? We assess adductor pollicis. Adductor means it will bring the thumb towards the fingers, adductor pollicis. And if by stimulating ulnar nerve there is contraction of adductor pollicis muscle, then we can see that we have overcome the effect. Now how we will do in this cases of train of four, what we will be doing, we will give four electrical stimulus. That is why it is known as, we will give four electrical stimulus, okay, at 2 hertz. 2 hertz means every 0.5 seconds. Okay, every 0.5 seconds. Now what happens normally? Normally if you stimulate a nerve and a nerve releases acetylcholine, it will act on the muscle. And in each stimulus there is complete muscle contraction. So normally a muscle will contract on one stimulus, there is complete muscle contraction. So this muscle contraction is assessed by various parameters like electromyography. There is acceleromyography or kininomyography, but these important points are not important for you. So wherever you have given four electrical stimulus, so there will be first muscle contraction on first stimulus, then second muscle contraction, third muscle contraction, fourth muscle contraction. So this is the normal muscle contraction if you haven't given any skeletal muscle relaxant. So these four muscle contraction, we name it as T1, T2, T3 and T4. Okay. Now what will happen in cases of depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant and non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant like curare? Okay. Now we know that depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant, we cannot overcome the effect. While in non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant, we will overcome the effect. So in depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant, if you will give a stimulus, there will be less contraction of a muscle as compared to them. There will be less contraction of the muscle. Why less contraction? Because succinylcholine have blocked. If you are given the next stimulus, again there will be no effect, less muscle contraction. So this is the effect of succinylmethonium on the train of four. But when you have given a non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant, can we say acetylcholine will overcome the effect? So if acetylcholine will overcome the effect, there will be complete muscle contraction in T1. In T1, there will be complete muscle contraction. But the point is, as you have given the successive three stimulus, remember on the first stimulus, there is maximum acetylcholine release. And as you have given second, third and fourth stimulus, can we say the stores of acetylcholine have reduced? So subsequently there will be less acetylcholine release. As there is subsequently less acetylcholine release, so there will be less muscle contraction. So there will be less muscle contraction as compared to this. Because of, with successive muscle electrical stimulus, the amount of acetylcholine which is released is less. Okay, so the amount of acetylcholine released will be less, okay, because the stores will deplete. So this will be the effect on succinomyotonia, and this will be the effect in the cases of, in the case of, we will write that is curare like drug. So can we say that there will be gradual decrease in the tone? Now what is the importance of this? In this test, what we will do, we generally measure the ratio of T4 to T1. We measure this ratio. Can we say that in cases of normal muscle, the ratio should ideally be 1. T4 must be equal to T1. Do you agree? The fourth wave and first wave should be low. Now in this case, again the ratio will be 1. Okay. Now in cases of non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant, remember the ratio is less than 1. Less than 1. Okay. Now remember, if this ratio becomes more or more than 9, 0.9, if it becomes more than 9, that means the T4 waves is somewhat near to T1. Can we say that total muscle recovery has been occurred? Can we say if T4 wave is very large in cases of non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant, it will tell us about the ample amount of recovery. It will tell us about the recovery of muscle. Okay. So it will tell us about the recovery of muscle if T4 to T1 ratio is more than 0.9. Okay. So can we say that T4 wave is somewhat near to T1, which is just near to the normal value? So this is the train of force stimulus. Okay. Now let's talk about the second assessment. So this was the first assessment, train of force. Now second assessment we will write is double burst stimulation. Now what will happen in double burst stimulation? We will give two electrical stimulus of 50 hertz. Okay, and that should be 750 milliseconds apart. Okay, 700 milliseconds apart. So what will happen in a normal muscle? Suppose you have given the first electrical stimulus to the muscle, then you have given the second electrical stimulus to the muscle. In both cases, acetylcholine will be released. What will happen in the first stimulus? You have given a double burst stimulus. There is a normal muscle contraction, first stimulus. And after 750 seconds, you have given again a double burst stimulus. So this will be the normal muscle contraction. Okay. Now, can we say that in non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant, and non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant. Now in non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant like succinomyotonium, we know that acetylcholine will not able to overcome the effect of a muscle. It cannot overcome the effect. So there will be permanent decrease in the amplitude of the muscle contraction, which is measured by electromyography. So there will be reduction in the muscle. Okay, permanent reduction. Now what will happen in non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant? Here acetylcholine can overcome the effect. So if you will give the first contraction, acetylcholine will overcome the effect of the muscle. But after subsequent second stimulus, the amount of acetylcholine which is released from the nerve reduces. As the amount of nerve acetylcholine releases from the nerve reduces, so there will be no ample amount of contraction as compared to the first stimulus. Okay. First, second. So again, there will be gradual reduction in the muscle contraction. Okay. Gradual reduction in the muscle contraction. So it will also tell us about the ample recovery of the muscle. Okay. But remember, it will also tell us about the ample recovery of the muscle. Okay. Whether the muscles have been recovered or not after surgery, because during surgery we give curare like drug. But remember, it is more sensitive than train of four. It is more sensitive test than train of four. Okay, train of four. Now there are certain other tests also, so we will just write their names. So what will happen in double burst stimuli? Just like again, thus there is acetylcholine release. Acetylcholine will overcome the effect of curare, that is non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant. But in subsequent wave, the amount of acetylcholine reduce electrical stimuli by subsequent electrical stimuli, the amount of acetylcholine which is released is less. So in next phase, the amount of contraction will be less. Now let's talk about the last other two method of clinical assessment of action of skeletal muscle relaxant. So third and fourth we will also discuss. So what will happen in third one? The third method of assessment is known as post-tetanic potentiation. Okay, so this method is known as post-tetanic potentiation. It is also known as post-tetanic count. Okay, now, and the fourth one you will write, the last one you will write, is single burst stimuli. Single burst tetanic stimuli. Tetanic means continuous stimuli. Now what will happen in post-tetanic potentiation or count? Let's see. In this case, we will give a 50 hertz stimulus. We will give a 50 hertz electrical stimulus. Okay? 50 hertz electrical stimulus for continuous 5 seconds. For continuous 5 seconds. Then we will take a break of 3 seconds. Break of 3 seconds. And then we will give a small 1 hertz stimuli. So two stimulus will be given. One for 5 hertz wave. Now what will happen in a normal muscle? In normal muscle, when you have given a 50 hertz stimuli continuously, so there will be continuous muscle contraction or tetanic contraction. And after 3 seconds, there will be again single 1 hertz, means 1 or 2 single complete muscle contraction. So there will be complete muscle contraction. Okay, complete muscle contraction. Now what will happen in non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant like succinylcholine and non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant like curare? In depolarizing skeletal muscle contraction, we know that acetylcholine which is released by electrical stimulus will not able to overcome the effect. Hence, there will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, let's say. And after 3 seconds, there will be a small wave. And remember, their amplitude will be less because they cannot overcome the effect. Okay? Now, what will happen in cases of non-depolarizing? We know that in cases of non-depolarizing, acetylcholine can overcome the effect, competitive blocker, so we can overcome. So first wave, when you will be given, there will be complete overcome because the amount of acetylcholine release is very high, but gradually it will reduce. Okay, because on repetitive electrical stimuli, the amount of acetylcholine which is released from the nerve reduces. Now after 3 seconds, there will be ample recovery. The stores of acetylcholine will be again available to get released. Again, there will be complete muscle contraction. Again, there will be complete muscle contraction after 3 seconds. Okay, in cases of non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant. Now, the last one we have is tetanic stimuli. Okay, tetanic stimuli. Here, what we will be doing, we will be giving, it is just like the first phase. It is just like the first phase of post-tetanic potentiation. Here we will give a 50 hertz stimuli for 5 seconds or more. Okay, but it is given only once. There is no single break of 3 seconds and all. And what will happen? We know that in a single tetanic stimuli, normal muscle will contract completely. In cases of depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant, there will be less contraction or incomplete contraction, okay, because acetylcholine cannot overcome the effect. While in cases of non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant like curare, there will be complete recovery because acetylcholine can overcome, but the amount of acetylcholine which is released will be less. Hence, the contraction of the muscle will reduce. It will be same like this, okay. Now, if you talk about now, the most, how we will assess them. So this assessment, remember, is done during surgery when the patient is unconscious. We can apply this method and we can assess the recovery of a muscle. Now remember, the most common nerve we use, we stimulate by electrical stimulus, is ulnar nerve. Okay, but you can also do facial nerve stimulation. Now facial nerve stimulation can also be done, because facial nerve, it is done near sternocleidomastoid. Okay, during the outward course of facial nerve. Now if facial ulnar nerve is stimulated, remember in which muscle we see the response. The muscle contraction we see in cases of ulnar nerve most commonly is adductor pollicis. We will see the inward or towards the finger contraction movement of the thumb towards the fingers. Okay. Now in cases of facial nerve, we will see the contraction of orbicularis oculi. So it will lead to eye blinking, blinking of eyebrows. Okay, eyebrow contraction of eyebrow blinking, or we can do orbicularis oculi, oris. Here we will be seeing contraction of lips, but this is the most commonly used muscle, orbicularis oculi and adductor pollicis. Okay, and the muscle contractions are very feeble. They are generally cannot be assessed by naked eye. So the assessment of muscle contraction is done with various techniques like electromyography, okay, acceleromyography, and kinemomyography. Okay, so these contraction lines which we have made like this, decrease, they are assessed on these techniques. Okay. Okay, these lines of muscle contraction, they come here. Okay, so this is how we assess. Now let's discuss about the further differences between non-depolarizing and depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant. So the if you talk about depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant and non-depolarizing, the muscle sensitivity, if you talk about, if you have given a drug to the patient, which muscle will be the first muscle to relax or get paralyzed? The first muscle to get paralyzed in cases of succinomyotonia. In cases of succinomyotonia, remember, is neck muscles. They are the first muscle to get paralyzed. And the last and the most resistant muscle is diaphragm. And in cases of curare like drug, the first muscle to get paralyzed is fingers, and the last muscle, which is the most resistant muscle, is again diaphragm. So this is the order of muscle paralysis. Okay, but if you will talk about the recovery of muscles, make it opposite. Diaphragm is the first muscle to recover, and neck muscles will be the last muscle to recover. Similarly, diaphragm will be the first muscle to recover and the last muscle to paralyze. Fingers will be the last muscles to recover. Okay, last muscle to recover. Okay, now let's talk about now the pharmacokinetics of these drugs. Okay, let's talk about now their properties or pharmacokinetics. Okay, now if you talk about pharmacokinetic, what is the route of administration of these skeletal muscle relaxants, both depolarizing and non-depolarizing? Remember, these drugs are highly ionized drugs. Highly ionized means that they are highly water soluble, and remember, a water soluble drug cannot cross a cell membrane barrier. So can you give them orally? They cannot be given orally. Similarly, will they cross blood-brain barrier? No, they will not cross blood-brain barrier. Okay, so what is the route of administration? Hence, they are given directly into the blood. They are given by injections. So their route of administration is injection. Either they are given intramuscular injection or intravenous injections. Okay, now if you talk about their properties, which of the following skeletal muscle relaxant is shortest? We will write fastest, longest, which require least dose. Least dose means most potent. Most potent means least dose to produce effect, and least potent means highest dose, maximum dose. So if you talk about the shortest skeletal muscle relaxant, that is succinylcholine. Remember, succinylcholine is also known as succinylcholine. Okay, so it is depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant. It is overall the shortest acting. But if you talk about non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant, the shortest acting you will write is gantacuvium. Gantacuvium. But the problem with gantacuvium is right now gantacuvium is not approved. Hence, the next approved shortest acting skeletal muscle relaxant you will write is mivacuvium. Okay, mivacuvium among non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant. But overall shortest acting is succinylcholine. So overall shortest acting we have is succinylcholine. Now overall fastest acting again we will write is succinylcholine. That is succinylcholine also. Okay, but if you talk about non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant, that is rocuronium or rapacuronium. Exactly same mechanism of action, fastest acting. As these drugs are very fastest acting drug, remember these three drugs, they are given for rapid endotracheal intubation. These drugs are given for endotracheal tube intubation, and overall drug of choice is succinylcholine for endotracheal tube insertion. Now longest acting we will write is doxycycline. Okay, and if doxycycline is not given, you will write pancuronium. Overall longest is doxycycline. Most potent, which require least doses, again doxycycline. And the least potent, which is now not used, is galamine. Okay, so this is the complete list. Now how these drugs are removed out of the body? So if you talk about their metabolism and elimination, okay, now the first drug you will write, is succinylcholine, also known as succinylcholinium, and mivacuvium. As you can see that they are the shortest acting drug. Now why they are the shortest acting drug? Because they are degraded in our blood only. They are degraded by in our blood or plasma by an enzyme known as pseudocholine esterases. So they don't have to go to any liver or any other organ to degrade. They degrade in the blood only by pseudocholine esterase. That is why they are the shortest acting drug. Okay, pseudocholine esterase, remember, is also known as butyryl choline esterase. Okay, so first one. Now second one you will write that there is a drug gantacuvium. Gantacuvium, remember, is degraded by a process, cysteine adduction. Now there is a amino acid cysteine. This cysteine will come and attach to gantacuvium, and gantacuvium become neutralized. So right now gantacuvium is not approved, but remember the antidote to reverse the effect of gantacuvium will be cysteine when it will get approved. Okay, now the fourth one you will write, third one you will write is cisetracurium. Now cisetracurium, remember, doesn't need any enzyme or any organ to get metabolized. It undergoes spontaneous metabolism. This process is known as Hoffman elimination. Okay, Hoffman elimination means when we give cisetracurium, cisetracurium rapidly converts from lipid soluble into water soluble. It becomes spontaneously metabolized. It is spontaneous metabolism, and it gets spontaneously, after metabolism it becomes water soluble. It easily gets excreted out in urine. You will write 100%. Now the fourth drug is etracurium. Okay, etracurium. Now, etracurium also gets metabolized by Hoffman elimination, but it is also get eliminated by an enzyme present in our plasma known as plasma esterases. So can we say that these two drugs, 100% of cis etracurium and some amount of etracurium, gets spontaneously metabolized by Hoffman elimination? Now remember that these two drugs, because of this reason, that they don't need any organ or any organ or any enzyme generally to get eliminated out of the body. Because of this reason, these two skeletal muscle relaxants are the safest skeletal muscle relaxant in hepatic and renal failure. These two are the safest skeletal muscle relaxant in hepatic and renal failure because they undergo elimination spontaneously by a process known as Hoffman elimination. Okay, and if among them you have to choose which is even more safer, overall safest you will write is cis-etracurium. Cis-etracurium is even more safer as compared to etracurium. Okay, etracurium. So overall is cis-etracurium. But there is a point out here that sometimes this etracurium, after Hoffman elimination, it forms a toxic metabolite. It gets converted into a metabolite known as lodanosine. Now remember, this lodanosine sometimes or rarely, although it is not clinically seen, rarely accumulates in the body, and this lodanosine sometimes or rarely causes seizures. Rarely. But it's a very rare side effect. What about cis-etracurium? Even less or no as compared to etracurium, it forms negligible amount of this toxic metabolite after Hoffman elimination. So overall safest acting skeletal muscle relaxant becomes cis-etracurium. Now, what about all other skeletal muscle relaxant? All other skeletal muscle relaxant, remember, they are eliminated out of the body by hepatic plus renal route combined. Okay, combined liver, that means they are eliminated out in bile, and they are eliminated out in urine also, both. Okay, but remember, there are certain skeletal muscle relaxant which are purely removed by hepatic route, pure hepatic elimination. That means they are purely eliminated out in bile, not in urine. Similarly, pure renal elimination, that means they are only removed out in urine, not in bile. So these drugs are, we will write, so these drugs are pure hepatic route, we will write rocuronium. And here we will write doxycurium. So doxycurium only gets eliminated out in urine. Rocuronium only gets eliminated out in bile. Because of this reason, rocuronium is contraindicated. Rocuronium is contraindicated in biliary obstruction. If there is biliary obstruction, rocuronium should not be given, because rocuronium will not be eliminated out in bile if bile cannot outflow. Okay. Now let's talk about their combined side effects, overall side effect. Now the first side effect of skeletal muscle relaxants is, remember, these skeletal muscle relaxants are basic drugs. They go into the cell known as mast cells. In mast cells, remember, there is an acidic molecule known as heparin, which is attached to a basic molecule known as histamine. Okay? So when we give this basic skeletal muscle relaxant, these skeletal muscle relaxant, they go inside the mast cell and they themselves bind to heparin because they are basic. Because of this reason, this histamine is released. Okay? So these skeletal muscle relaxant, remember, they release histamine from the mast cells. From mast cell, because histamine will become free. Now, as this histamine will be released from the mast cell, it will produce asthma, that is bronchoconstriction. It will lead to sudden hypotension due to vasodilatation produced by histamine. And due to vasodilatation on skin, it can lead to facial flushing. So remember these reactions. We know that when histamine is released from the mast cell is known as anaphylaxis. These reactions are also known as anaphylactoid reaction. Because remember, when antigen comes and releases histamine from the mast cell, it is known as anaphylaxis. Okay? But here we know there is no antigen. They are directly causing release of histamine from the mast cells. Hence, they are known as anaphylactoid reactions. Now, which of the following drugs causes maximum histamine release from the mast cell? The drug which causes maximum histamine release from the mast cell is D-tubocurare. So, which drug can cause maximum chance of asthma hypotension? That is D-tubocurare. Minimum or not seen with, that is the safest skeletal muscle relaxant, sisetracurium. Sisetracurium does not release histamine from the mast cells. Okay, so remember this part. Now, the second point is, the second question, side effect we will write. As we know that skeletal, that these drugs, they block NM receptors present on skeletal muscles. They block NM receptors present on the skeletal muscle. Okay, but remember there is one more nicotinic receptor known as NN receptors. Now this NN receptor, remember where it is present. This NN receptor is present in ganglia. It is present in ganglia. Okay, or you can write post synaptic neuron of both parasympathetic ganglia and sympathetic ganglia. Okay, parasympathetic and sympathetic ganglia. Okay, so some of these skeletal muscle relaxants, they interact with nicotinic N receptor as well, okay, which is a part of autonomic nervous system. Now if you talk about action on NN receptor, remember, is also known as ganglionic receptor. So what are ganglionic receptors? You have to see the complete videos of ANS. Okay, there we have discussed a topic, ganglionic receptor and ganglionic blocker. Now if you talk about the action on NN receptors, we will write, what about succinylcholine? Okay, succinylcholine. And what about curare like drugs, especially maximum, you will write D-tubocurare. Okay, you will write that succinylcholine, we know succinylcholine initially stimulate NN receptor, NM, and after that it blocks NM receptor. That is why it was known as depolarizing type of skeletal muscle relaxant. So this succinylcholine, remember, it initially stimulate vagus nerve or vagus ganglia. Okay, after that it will block this vagus ganglia. Okay, it will block this vagal ganglia. So can we say that initially succinylcholine will have vagomimetic property, and after that it will become vagolytic. Vagolytic means it will block vagus nerve. Now we know that vagus nerve on heart normally suppresses heart rate, decreases heart rate. Okay, so due to initial vagomimetic effect, remember, succinylcholine initially causes bradycardia, and after that it will cause tachycardia. Because this nerve initially is vagomimetic, it will stimulate vagal ganglia, and after that it will become vagolytic. Okay, now what about curare? Remember, curare are only and only vagolytic. They are only vagolytic, As they are only vagolytic, what they will do? They will only do tachycardia. They will only produce tachycardia. And maximum vagolytic action and maximum tachycardia is produced by D-tubocurare. This is an important question. D-tubocurare has maximum. Now, which drug does not interfere with ganglia? Does not interfere with any vagomimetic or vagolytic activity? That is, we will write V-curonium. Now, V-curonium is a drug, remember, it has no vagolytic or vagomimetic activity. So, can we say that this V-curonium, as we know, V for vagus, V-curonium does not interfere with vagus. Because of this reason, can we say it will not produce any bradycardia or tachycardia? It is the most cardiostable, that it will not interfere with the heart rate. It is the most cardiostable drug, and this V-curonium, that is why, is the drug of choice as a skeletal muscle relaxant during cardiac surgeries. So, during cardiac surgeries, we give V-curonium because V-curonium does not interfere with vagus nerve. Okay? So, V-curonium does not interfere with vagus nerve. It is most cardiostable. Okay? So, remember this part. Now, let's talk about now certain individual drugs. Let's talk about now individual drugs and their property. So, the first individual drug we will start is depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant, and the very famous drug we know is succinylcholine. Okay, a very famous drug is succinylcholine. Now, remember, this succinylcholine is also known as succinylcholine. It is also known as succinylcholine. It is also known as choline. It is also known as scoline. So, let's talk about this drug in great detail. Now, we know that this succinylcholine is the shortest and it is the fastest acting overall skeletal muscle relaxant. It is the shortest and the fastest overall skeletal muscle relaxant. Okay. Now, if you talk about its onset of action comes within 1 to 1.5 minutes. And its total duration of action is 5 to 8 minutes. So, its action will get over in 5 to 8 minutes. Because of this reason, it is only used in cases of intubation. When you want to put an endotracheal tube. So, we give this injection of succinylcholine. And after 1 to 1.5 minutes, we will insert an endotracheal tube. Okay. So, any other drug you can also give in cases of intubation. Remember, the other drug which you can give in cases of intubations are rocuronium and rapacuronium. Now, rocuronium and rapacuronium, I told you, they are the second fastest acting drug. Okay, second fastest acting drug. But overall drug of choice for intubation is succinylcholine or succinylcholine. Okay, now let's talk about its property. Let's talk about its structure. Now, the structure of succinylcholine is, there are two molecules of acetylcholine which are linked together by their acetyl group. Okay, this is the structure of succinylcholine. So, two molecules of acetylcholine are linked together by acetyl group. Okay, now at what temperature it will be stored? So, you will write two molecules of acetylcholine. So it should be stored in 2 degree to 8 degree Celsius. What is the shelf life of its solution? The shelf life is 2 years. Okay, the shelf life of succinylcholine is 2 years. Okay, so two molecules of acetylcholine, it is stored in 2 to 8 degree Celsius, shelf life is 2 years. Okay, now, how it is degraded or metabolized in the body, try to recall. The metabolism of how it is degraded, succinylcholine is degraded in our plasma by an enzyme known as pseudocholine esterase enzyme. Okay, pseudocholine esterase enzyme degrades succinylcholine. It is also known as butyrylcholine esterase. Okay, butyrylcholine esterase. Now the point is, in cases of genetic deficiency of this enzyme or atypical form of pseudocholine esterase enzyme, can we say that the action of succinylcholine will become long acting because it will not able to degrade in the body? Because if this enzyme is deficient, the amount of succinylcholine will become very high in the body. It can produce toxicity of succinylcholine. Okay, and the most dangerous toxicity is that it can even paralyze respiratory muscles. It can cause paralysis of respiratory muscles even, and the person can go into apnea. Apnea means the breathing will be stopped. So can we say that before giving succinylcholine, we should assess the genetic makeup of an individual? We should assess the genetic makeup of an individual, whether this enzyme is present or not. So remember, before giving succinylcholine, do pharma means drug, genetic testing. Okay, for pseudocholine esterase enzyme. Okay, do pharmacogenetic testing for pseudocholine esterase enzyme, and that test is known as we will write Dubuquin number. So how we assess the levels of pseudocholine esterase? By a test known as Dubuquin number. Okay, Dubuquin number. Now let's see, what do we mean by the word Dubuquin number? Okay, let's understand what is Dubuquin. Now remember, this Dubuquin is one of the local anesthetic, and this Dubuquin, remember, normally it inhibits pseudocholine esterase enzyme. It inhibits pseudocholine esterase enzyme. Okay, now this Dubuquin number, it normally inhibits pseudocholine esterase enzyme. It normally inhibits, we will write 80% of typical pseudocholine esterase enzyme. If pseudocholine esterase enzyme is normal in the body, 80% of this is inhibited in normal condition by Dubuquin. But remember, if it is present atypical variety, remember, it can only inhibit 20% of it. 20% of atypical pseudocholine esterase is inhibited by Dubuquin. So what we will be doing, we will give this Dubuquin to our patient, and we will see that how much amount of pseudocholine esterase is inhibited. So we will write first is Dubuquin number. Okay, Dubuquin number. Okay, we will write three numbers. First, we will write 70 to 80. Can we say that it has inhibited all of the typical pseudocholine esterase enzyme? So these individuals are homozygous. That means they have both genes, and they both are producing typical pseudocholine esterase enzyme, which is seen in normal individuals. Okay. Now, if this number is coming out to be, leave one line, 20 to 30. Now, can we say that this type of individual is homozygous atypical? That most of this enzyme present in that individual is atypical variety. So this is an abnormal. And there could be a number which will make a mean of these two numbers, that is 50 to 60. So these individuals are known as heterozygous atypical. So these individuals are borderline. Okay, borderline individual. Okay, these individuals are borderline. So this is Dubuquin number is given to assess the level of pseudocholinesterase, whether they are typical or they are atypical. Okay. Now let's talk about the toxicity of succinylcholine. What are the toxic effects of succinylcholine? The first side effect or toxic effect of succinylcholine is hyperkalemia. It is hyperkalemia. Now why it causes hyperkalemia? The reason is, suppose this is the muscle. We know that when the muscle is not contracting, outside the muscle we have sodium and inside the muscle we mainly have potassium. Okay, inside the muscle we mainly have potassium. Now when we give this succinylcholine, we know that succinylcholine is a depolarizing blocker. Initially it will cause depolarization of muscle. Now due to depolarization of muscle, remember, depolarization of muscle causes potassium efflux. There is efflux of potassium from the muscle into the blood and it will lead to hyperkalemia. Now what is the effect of hyperkalemia in the body? Now remember, hyperkalemia causes cardiac arrest. Okay, cardiac arrest, or you will write asystole. It will lead to muscle weakness. The muscle will not able to contract properly. So hyperkalemia can cause severe muscle weakness or cardiac arrest or asystole. Hence it is a very dangerous condition. Okay, very dangerous condition. Now if there is any risk of hyperkalemia, we should not give succinylcholine in those cases. So remember, succinylcholine is contraindicated in cases of, if you are combining them with potassium sparing diuretics like spironolactone, because potassium sparing diuretics causes hyperkalemia. Digoxin also causes hyperkalemia. Trauma to the muscles, because trauma will release potassium into the blood. Okay, you will write burns will also cause injury to the cell and potassium will come out. And rhabdomyolysis means necrosis of skeletal muscle. All these conditions, they themselves can cause hyperkalemia. And any condition which leads to hyperkalemia, remember, here succinylcholine should never be given. It is absolutely contraindicated in all these conditions. Okay. Now the second side effect of succinylcholine we will write is, it causes a very dangerous side effect known as malignant hyperthermia. Okay, malignant hyperthermia. Now what is malignant hyperthermia? Let's understand. Suppose this is the muscle. Remember, we know that succinylcholine causes initial depolarization and sodium moves inside. Remember, when sodium comes inside, this sodium goes to smooth endoplasmic reticulum, and this smooth endoplasmic reticulum, remember, releases calcium. This calcium causes contraction of muscle, and sometimes there is very massive calcium release from smooth endoplasmic reticulum, which can lead to extreme rigidity. There will be increase in temperature of the body, hyperthermia, and sometimes there will be muscle degeneration, rhabdomyolysis. Okay, these are the features of malignant hyperthermia because of massive release of calcium from the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Okay, remember, it's an emergency condition. So why it occurs? Due to massive calcium release from smooth endoplasmic reticulum. So it can lead to extreme muscle rigidity, hyperthermia or increase in body temperature, and rhabdomyolysis. Okay, now remember, what are the drugs which causes malignant hyperthermia? Succinylcholine is one of them. So drugs causing malignant hyperthermia are, you will write a mnemonic shell. The first is succinylmethonium or succinylcholine. Second is one general anesthetic agent, halothane, atropine, and lignocaine. These drugs can cause malignant hyperthermia, and among them halothane causes most commonly. Maximum incidence is seen with halothane. Now, what is the treatment of malignant hyperthermia? The treatment of malignant hyperthermia is rapid cooling. Okay, rapid cooling of the body. Give 100% oxygen, correct acidosis. Because of release of lactic acid from the muscle. Now, the drug of choice for the treatment of malignant hyperthermia is dantrolene. So, this dantrolene we will be discussing shortly, because dantrolene inhibits calcium release from smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Okay, so we will be discussing dantrolene shortly in skeletal muscle relaxant. Okay, now remember that succinylcholine is absolutely contraindicated in muscle dystrophies. If there is already muscle weakness due to genetic defect in the muscle, and it is absolutely contraindicated in neurological abnormalities. Suppose there is, let's say, patient is having hemiplegia due to stroke, already the muscle is very weak. You can write Guillain-Barré syndrome. So, if already the muscles are paralyzed because of neurological abnormality, succinylcholine will aggravate this condition. So, you remember, it will enhance muscle weakness. In these conditions, succinylcholine is absolutely contraindicated. Now, let's talk about non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant. Non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant, that is curare-like drug. So, we will write their individual property. The first drug you will write is mivacurium. Mivacurium, remember, is one of the shortest acting drug. Because of this reason, it is used in daycare surgeries. It is used during daycare surgeries when you have to discharge the patient on the same day. Okay, you will write rocuronium and rapacuronium. So, they were the second fastest acting drug after succinylcholine. They are given for endotracheal tube intubation. Okay, then we will write D-tubocurare. Now, D-tubocurare, remember, causes maximum hypotension. Why? Because it causes maximum histamine release. Because of this reason, nowadays it is rarely used, not used. It is rarely used. But it can be used sometimes in hypertensive people. It can be used in hypertensive individuals. Okay. We have already discussed that weak uronium is most cardiostable. It is most cardiostable. Okay, it has no interaction with the ganglionic receptor or NN receptor. That is why it was the drug of choice in cardiac surgeries. In cardiac surgeries. We will write now pancuronium. Now remember pancuronium, remember it inhibits reuptake of norepinephrine in nerves. Remember, when nerve releases norepinephrine, its action is terminated by reuptake. If we inhibit the reuptake of norepinephrine, the level of norepinephrine increases, and norepinephrine is a sympathetic molecule. It produces vasoconstriction. It produces vasoconstriction and it leads to hypertension. Okay, it leads to hypertension. Can we say that more blood will be go to the heart if there will be hypertension or venoconstriction? More blood will reach to the heart. So, it will increase venous return to the heart. Okay. It will increase venous return to the heart. And remember, because of this reason, it is the drug of choice in congenital heart diseases, in which the patient has right to left shunt or hole in the heart. Okay, Because if the heart is having right to right atria or right ventricle to left ventricle, if we will increase the pressure or venous return, the blood can directly go from right heart into the left heart. Okay. So, because in those congenital heart disease, we prefer to give pancuronium. Okay. Pancuronium. Now, let's talk about if their toxicity comes or we have to reverse the effect of skeletal muscle relaxant, the reversal of skeletal muscle relaxant, how to recover their effect. Okay. Now, for the reversal of skeletal muscle relaxant, remember the drug of choice to reverse their effect, the drug of choice is neostigmine. Overall drug of choice is neostigmine. You can also use a short acting drug, that is idrofonium. Okay, idrofonium. Now, what these drugs are, remember these drugs, they inhibit degradation of acetylcholine by inhibiting an enzyme, choline esterases. So, they are anti-choline esterases. They increase acetylcholine level and acetylcholine will overcome the effect. And remember, they are the drug of choice to reverse the effect in cases of non-depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant like curare-like drug. Okay. But remember, they are not effective in cases of succinylcholine or succinomethonium. Okay. They cannot reverse the effect of succinomethonium or depolarizing skeletal muscle relaxant. They are only given in cases of non-depolarizing. So, we don't have any drug to reverse the effect of succinomethonium. Okay. But remember, we have developed a new drug. A new drug is Sugammadex. We have developed a new drug, Sugammadex. Now, what is Sugammadex? We will write Sugammadex is gamma cyclodextrin. Gamma word is coming. Okay, gamma means gamma. Dex means you will write dextrin. So, full form you will write cyclodextrin. Easy to remember name. Gamma cyclodextrin. Now, what is this, sir? This is a lipid soluble compound. It's a lipid soluble compound. It will directly engulf or it will chemically bind. It will chemically antagonize or bind with steroidal curare like drugs. Okay, so it's a lipid soluble. It will directly engulf or chemically bind with steroidal skeletal muscle relaxant like, you will write, those drugs are, you will write rocuronium and vicuronium. So, for the steroidal curare like drug, okay, steroidal drug, we have discussed this divided curare like drug into steroidal benzoisoquinoline and galamine. So, it will directly engulf the steroidal drug into inside them and the steroidal drug will not able to act on NM receptors. So, this Sugammadex is made as an antidote only for rocuronium and vicuronium steroidal skeletal muscle relaxant. Okay. But overall, the drug of choice to reverse the effect is neostigmine. Okay. Neostigmine. So, these are the drugs, all about the drugs which are acting on NM receptors. Okay. Now, let's talk about the second class of skeletal muscle relaxant, that is directly acting muscle relaxant. So, these drugs, remember, they will directly act on the level of skeletal muscles. Now, let's see how skeletal muscle generally contract. Let's see how skeletal muscle contracts generally. Suppose this is a skeletal muscle. We know that skeletal muscle becomes depolarized when sodium comes inside. Okay, sodium comes inside. And this sodium, remember, goes to an organelle known as smooth endoplasmic reticulum. And this smooth endoplasmic reticulum, remember, releases calcium. This calcium causes binding of actin and myosin. Okay, due to binding of actin and myosin, there is contraction of muscle. So here two ions are involved. First, influx of sodium, which causes depolarization, which releases calcium from the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Now we have two classes of drug which will go inside the muscle and directly inhibit this process. The first drug we have is quinine. And the second drug we have is dantrolene. So these are the two skeletal muscle relaxants we are discussing now. Now quinine, you will write, it blocks sodium channel. It blocks sodium channel. Okay, or sodium entry. Because of this reason, it will directly relax the muscle. This quinine has been approved for the treatment of nocturnal leg cramps. And here it is the drug of choice. When there is sudden muscle contraction while sleeping in the legs, it is also given in myotonia congenita, where the muscle tone is increased. Okay, only two uses. Now, a very important drug that is for you is dantrolene. So let's make a heading. It's a very important drug. Let's talk about this dantrolene. Remember, dantrolene, it inhibit calcium release from smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Okay, so this sodium is inhibited by quinine, and this calcium release from smooth endoplasmic reticulum is inhibited by dantrolene. Okay, so let's make a heading, dantrolene. It comes with a salt known as dantrolene sodium. Okay, dantrolene sodium. Now, what is the mechanism of action of dantrolene? Suppose this is a smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Now, remember, this smooth endoplasmic reticulum, it releases calcium. It releases calcium. This receptors through which it releases calcium is known as SER, that is smooth endoplasmic reticulum, CA, Sarca channels. So I hope you have understood the meaning of Sarca, that is smooth endoplasmic reticulum calcium channel. Remember, they are also known as ryanodine receptors. Ryanodine receptors. Okay. But remember, these ryanodine receptor, which is also known as Sarca 1 or ryanodine receptor 1, RYR1. Similarly, we have Sarca 2 or ryanodine receptor 2. Remember, ryanodine receptor 1 is present on which muscle? We will write skeletal muscle. While Sarca 2 or ryanodine receptor 2, remember, they are present in heart or cardiac muscles. They both are of different types. Cardiac muscles. Okay. Now, if you talk about the mechanism of action of dantrolene, remember, dantrolene blocks ryanodine receptor 1 or Sarca 1 on skeletal muscles only. It blocks release of this calcium in skeletal muscle only, in this receptors. Okay, while it doesn't have any action on cardiac muscles. Because of this reason, we know that calcium causes muscle contraction. The muscles will relax. It will cause direct skeletal muscle relaxation. It will have direct skeletal muscle relaxation. But you have to remember, it has no cardiac effect. It has no cardiac effects. So it's a very important drug for you. Now, where this dantrolene sodium is used? If you talk about this dantrolene sodium is used in cases of severe muscle rigidity, which causes hyperthermia. Because muscle contraction causes increase in heat production. So this hyperthermia, you can write, it is the drug of choice for a condition known as malignant hyperthermia, which we have already discussed, drug of choice. It is also given in cases of neuroleptic malignant syndrome. Both are somewhat same etiology, same, but the cause is different. Say they have same presentation, both have hyperthermia. Now, neuroleptic malignant syndrome is due to the use of antipsychotic drugs like haloperidol that block dopamine receptors. That block dopamine receptor in basal ganglia. Because of this reason, there is sudden muscle contraction in the whole body. Okay. So the drug of choice for in these two condition is dantrolene sodium, both condition, because both condition presents with hyperthermia. Now, what is the route of administration of dantrolene? It is given orally as well as IV. What is the side effect of dantrolene? We will write the most common side effect is diarrhea. Sometimes it could be dangerous, it is hepatotoxic, and rarely it may cause hyperkalemia. Rarely it may cause hyperkalemia when used with calcium channel blockers. When it is used with calcium channel blocker, it may cause hyperkalemia. Okay, so this is about the drugs which act on directly on muscle. Now the last class of drug among skeletal muscle relaxant we have is centrally acting skeletal muscle relaxant. Okay, centrally acting skeletal muscle relaxant. So these drugs, remember, they act at a level of brain and spinal cord. Okay, they will act at a level of brain and spinal cord. Okay, now let's talk about these drugs, where these drugs are generally used. Let's see what are the uses of these drugs. These drugs are used in cases of muscle rigidity due to stroke. We will write cerebral palsy. Okay, they may cause a case of rigidity known as decerebrate rigidity. Here the muscle becomes contracted. They are also used in cases of multiple sclerosis. We will write upper motor neuron lesion known as amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. We will write spinal injuries. We will write infection known as tetanus. So all these conditions are the conditions of upper motor neuron lesions. Because of this reason, the peripheral nerves, their activity increases. There is severe muscle spasm in the whole body. There is severe muscle spasm in the whole body. Hence, we will give the drug which will act at a level of brain and spinal cord. Okay? Brain and spinal cord. Now, let's see what are the drugs we have. Okay? Let's see what are the drugs we have. The first class of drugs we have, we will write, is benzodiazepines. Remember, benzodiazepines, they act on a receptor known as GABA-A chloride channel agonist. Okay, they are GABA-A chloride channel agonist. They are also GABA-B agonist. Don't write chloride out here. GABA-B is a GPCR. Okay, remember, GABA-A is present in brain and GABA-B is present in spinal cord. And GABA receptor, remember, is an inhibitory receptor. It decreases inhibitory neurotransmitter. It decreases muscle tone. Okay, it decreases muscle tone. So which drug we generally use? The drug which is used generally is diazepam and other drugs. What is the main side effect? As it is acting at a level of brain, all these drugs, they may cause sedation. Sedation. Okay, now the second class of drug we will write is baclofen. Baclofen. Now remember, baclofen is only and only GABA B agonist. That is why the word baclofen has come. Only, not on GABA A. So can we say that this baclofen will act at a level of spinal cord only? It will act at a level of spinal cord only, as we have seen that GABA A was present in the brain, GABA B was present in spinal cord. So it act at a level of spinal cord only. So it has a great advantage. The great advantage is that this baclofen is least sedative drug. It is least sedative drug. Okay. Now, where this baclofen is used, you'll write that this baclofen, it is overall the most preferred drug in those conditions which we have written above. It is the most preferred drug. Okay. But remember, it is not effective in, it is not effective in decerebrate rigidity. Remember, decerebrate rigidity occurs at the level of cortex, not at a level of spinal cord, like cases of stroke and cerebral palsy. In these two conditions, it is not effective. Okay, decerebrate. But can we say that in cases of decerebrate rigidity, benzodiazepines are effective because they are acting at a level of brain also? So in decerebrate rigidity, benzodiazepines are effective in everything. Okay. Now the third class of drug you will write is tizanidine, a very important drug for you. So mark it as char. It's very important. Now tizanidine, remember, it acts at a level of brain and spinal cord both, and it acts at a level of a receptor known as alpha 2A receptor agonist. Okay. Now remember, there are certain nerves in our brain which releases excitatory neurotransmitter. This excitatory neurotransmitter acts on other nerves, and the signal moves inside, and the signal moves inside into the spinal cord and brain. Now remember, this alpha 2 receptor is present on that same neuron which is releasing this acetylcholine. And if we stimulate this alpha 2A receptor, which is a presynaptic receptor, presynaptic means it is present in that same neuron where it is releasing excitatory neurotransmitter. Now remember, when we stimulate this receptor, it applies a brake. It will inhibit the release of excitatory neurotransmitter. So it is presynaptic inhibitory receptor. Okay, that is why stimulated tizanidine. Okay, now the fourth class of drug we have is mifepristone group. So it's a group, mifepristone group. Okay, now mifepristone group, remember, they act at a level of spinal cord mainly. And they block which nerve? Remember, they block internuncial neurons. Internuncial neurons are again the type of interneurons. And these interneurons, remember, due to the blockage of internuncial neuron, remember, these neurons are responsible for reflex contraction. Because of this reason, they block reflex muscle contraction. So they only function when we want sudden muscle contraction. Remember, they have no effect on resting muscle tone. Okay, so in normal condition, the muscle will not be affected. They have no effect on resting muscle tone. So let's see what are the drugs we have. So because of this reason, they are generally used for localized muscle spasms. They are used for localized muscle spasms. If you take an example like torticollis, when there is sudden muscle spasm of sternocleidomastoid. Similarly, lumbago or back pain, there is sudden muscle spasm in the back. Normally, the muscle tone is normal. Okay, sprain, bursitis during sports injuries, we get this drug. Okay. So let's see what are the drugs we have. You just have to remember the names, not much important nowadays, these drugs. So the first drug is mifepristone. Second, you will write methocarbamol. Third, you will write carisoprodol. Chloroxazone. Okay, so these are the drugs. Among them, mifepristone now is not used. It is not available. It was the first drug to be developed. Methocarbamol is a very important drug, very commonly used in cases of torticollis. Okay, and these are the drugs we have among mifepristone group. okay, and this completes our all skeletal muscle relaxants. So thank you very much.